An outstanding 45 minutes from Georgetown here in the first half. They have a 2-1 lead over Maryland here in the first semifinal of the NCAA Men's College Cup. We go to first half highlights, and it starts off here against the run of the play. Maryland will get this goal from Chilo Shuma 21 minutes in.
Yeah, and it's the little deflection right there from Patrick Mullins. The little deflection to back post allows Shuma to get in behind. Question was, at that time of the deflection, Shuma's in behind the defense. That could have easily been called offside.
But then Steve Newman, who we gave the drum roll, would score what was a huge goal here off the turn to tie things up in the 32nd
minute. I just
minute.
Love what Newman's done this first half. His understanding of when to drop in behind his front line into the midfield, be that second runner, both goals, great technique. But it's the understanding of the run to get in those positions. I mean, what a goal this is.
The Newman show would continue. Banks it in off the post. This is only 2 minutes later. So talk about a player that you give the drum roll and living up to it today.
Yeah, and Georgetown has lived up to it. I mean, it's your first College Cup appearance, and you show up in this first half, completely dominate Maryland. It's been a great first half from Georgetown. Yeah,
and I don't think those stats, if we look at those, will absolutely tell a story at all here. I think it's been a dominant Georgetown.
It's been all Georgetown, particularly in that first half, particularly out wide. The outside backs getting forward in dangerous positions. The biggest thing that Georgetown has done to Maryland, Glenn, is Maryland, when they win the ball, they can't get out of their own end. They're playing much more direct than they're used to. It's been all Georgetown this first half.
All right, so we've seen Maryland this year get put under pressure by teams like Clemson and Brown, and they didn't react to it that well. Can they react to it in the second half, and how will it happen?
Of course they can, Glenn, because they have the horses. I mean, you heard Sasho yesterday after training. He believes he's got 19, 20 players. Well, that's the key. You got to show up. And coming into halftime, you could see it on his face. He was very disturbed that his players came out with heavy legs. They came out with no energy. First 5 minutes of this second half, Maryland has to come out, show energy, and make Georgetown defend a little bit more than they did the first half, which was very little.
Yeah, he told our own Monica Gonzalez that he was surprised because they had a wonderful week of training before this. Second half right around the corner here. Can Maryland turn it around? Georgetown, for the time being, has a 2-1 lead.
What's better, bigger or smaller?
Bigger!
So which would you rather have, a big treehouse or a small treehouse?
If it's big enough, you can have a disco.
Oh, yeah.
Why do you not want a smaller treehouse?
Because it wouldn't be able to fit a flat-screen TV, and the TV would be about this big, and you would have to hold the wire. In the position you would hold the wire, you wouldn't be able to see the TV.
That's a pain in the buns.
Yep. It's not complicated. Bigger is better, and AT&T has the nation's largest 4G network.
Lifts to clear obstacles. Lowers to cut drag. Rises to every challenge. The class-exclusive air suspension in the new 2013 Ram 1500. Engineered to move heaven and earth. Guts. Glory. Ram.
From our fresh pack sauce, to our fresh veggies, to our 100% fresh dough, never frozen, at Papa John's, we believe fresh is better. Nobody does what Papa John's does.
Try Papa John's 5-sausage pizza. Get a large for only $11. Or for just $1 more, choose any large pizza with your choice of toppings, even our signature specialty pizzas, like the Works. Plus, for a special treat, add Papa's new chicken poppers to your order.
Better ingredients, better pizza, Papa John's.
Here at Edge, we know it's important to get ready. And when we're getting ready to get ready, we get ready with Edge. It has lubricating molecules to help your razor give you a close shave and less irritation. Edge Shave Gel. Get your edge.
The holidays are here, and that means falling prices at Rent-A-Center. Right now, get a Samsung 43-inch plasma TV or a 5-piece bedroom set. Your choice, just $780. And with the Rack Flex plan, everyone's pre-approved for 90 days, same as cash.
There are over 400,000 NCAA student-athletes, and just about all of us will be going pro in something other than sports.
I'm a totally different man.
I lost 105 pounds.
97 pounds.
180 pounds.
Just get up and walk.
You want to change your life? Then you need to step up to the X9 from Nordic Track. What makes the X9 the best calorie-burning machine on the planet? Incline. Going up. Now you're burning twice the calories. You want more? Take it all the way to 40% incline for 5 times the calorie burn.
The X9 is the fastest way ever to lose weight.
And all you have to do is walk.
Plus, the X9 comes with iFit, powered by Google Maps, so you can work out anywhere.
Burn fat jogging on the beaches of Fiji. Shed pounds hiking the Swiss Alps.
With iFit, the X9 automatically adjusts, so your workout follows the terrain.
You can most definitely shed calories and burn fat.
You can just walk the calories off.
Get this innovative machine for zero down and a free upgrade to rush shipping.
To order, call 1-800-383-4153 or go online today.
Welcome back to ESPNU's coverage of the 2012 NCAA Men's College Cup presented by Enterprise Rent-A-Car. Semifinals, Georgetown, 2-1 leaders over the Maryland Terrapins. We are at Regents Park in Hoover, Alabama. Now, one of the big stories around Georgetown is the fact that they went on a foreign tour to Barcelona in the spring. They watched the great Lionel Messi in action with Barcelona in the Champions League. And Coach Brian, we said, hey, they grew an identity. They came together on this trip.
That's not bad, huh? Go to college, go to Georgetown. Hey, where are you going for this spring break? We're going to go to Barcelona.
Yeah, it became an
awesome experience.
Bonding experience. Wasn't like that back in my day, as we are joined now by Monica Gonzalez and the head coach of Georgetown, Brian Weiss. And Monica, take it away.
One of the most potent offenses at bay for 45 more minutes.
Well, I don't know. I don't know if you'll be able to. I mean, we think there's more goals in this game, and we talked a lot about handling the next one, whether Maryland gets it or if we get it. So, I mean, we don't want to be sitting here trying to defend these guys for 45 minutes. They're awfully athletic. They're awfully dangerous. And, we got to make sure that we can keep the ball in their half and try to make them defend a bit.
So can you talk about the play of your outside backs yesterday? You said if they're getting forward, that means that you guys are doing well. We expect to keep seeing them going forward in the second half.
Yeah, well, hopefully they don't know any other way to play. So we'd like to, as I say, if we can do that, that means that, we're in their half and we're making them defend. And best way to not concede a goal is to make sure that they don't have the ball.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
Glenn, back to you.
Thank you, Monica. Georgetown in the blue. Maryland in the white. 45 minutes away from determining who potentially will get in to the NCAA College Cup final. And this one steered away there by Keegan Rosenberry, who had an outstanding first half getting forward for Georgetown. See if this is a different Maryland coming out of the locker room here in the second half. Here's Jordan Cyrus now. Trying to get to the end line. He's sealed off there. Good defensive work. And it will be a corner, though, to Maryland, as working back defensively was Reamer, number 20 for Georgetown. So Cyrus getting forward from his right back position to help earn this corner. Taylor Kemp will come to take it for Maryland. Towards the near post. Defended well by Georgetown. Kemp is going to get there, though. He'll clip it back into the box. Rosenberry just whacks it forward. Substitutions in the second half. If you come off once, you are allowed to re-enter one time. If you're subbed out, it's unlimited substitution. Clock again ticks down here in the college game. Georgetown trying to take out three-time national champions Maryland. Jordan Cyrus. Well-measured pass. Taylor Kemp now. He'll go direct. Schuma's in the box. And it's Maryland now applying the high pressure here. Woodbury back to Cardona. Keep Cardona off his line. Goalkeeper that, according to Sasha Sarovsky, eliminated mistakes from last year. Become a goalkeeper who has more command of his penalty area and more confidence. Under pressure right now, big trouble. It's going to go in. It's deflected in. Caught at his feet and deflected in. It is now 3-1 Georgetown. And it is the big man up front who has been chasing everything, Brandon Allen for Georgetown.
And right on cue, you talking about what Cardona's done, eliminating the mistakes in the summertime and the springtime, grabbing number one. This ball has to be 30 rows, touch it out, away from your goal, too nonchalant. And listen, Brandon Allen did this 3 or 4 times in the first half. Some say it's stupid running, but look, it's putting pressure on a goalkeeper. He's rewarded for that hard work of just putting simple pressure on a goalkeeper that took his time. Georgetown's up 3-1.
A spectacular play from Brandon Allen, who we saw in the first half chasing everything and anything. And he's made a goal out of nothing here. It is now 3-1. What a start for Georgetown here in the second half.
What I'm talking about is so often you sometimes listen, save your legs as a center forward. Well, not in the College Cup semifinal. Put pressure on center backs, put pressure on the back four, put pressure on goalkeepers. That's exactly what that freshman just did. Brandon Allen chasing down, and he caught Cardona on a slow reaction on that first touch.
Especially against a team that has been a bit tentative here today. And he posed the question, produces a goal. It is 3-1 Georgetown. It's number 16 on the year for a freshman, Brandon Allen. He has been impressive. He's not played like a freshman. Woodbury heads it away. It is a big mountain to climb for Maryland now. Again, Georgetown has never beaten Maryland. 0-28. Pick a nice time to get win number one. Sasho Sarovsky has to be wondering if this is the same team that he has coached for the majority of this year. Nealis towards the corner flag. Good running from Reamer. Reamer in towards the near post. Woodbury cut it out. And conceded. Well, for a minute we thought it was, but it'll be a throw into Maryland now. And this Penso has stopped this game, is going to go check on Brandon Allen. Stunning start here to the second half, Taylor.
Well, and Maryland comes out, they put pressure initially, and it's a simple, silly mistake from Maryland that cost them. But it just begs the question. You look all week at the buildup, and everyone, I mean, not a single person in the country picked Georgetown to come in and have a shot at this game. Maybe not a shot, but to win the game. And I think it just allowed Georgetown to come in freely. And sometimes when you have so many expectations, that's where the heavy legs comes from. And right now, Maryland just, it's not the same team they've been all year long.
And they had a little bit of a struggle dealing with the pressure of the ACC tournament as well. So I remember Sasha Sarovsky telling us that, you know, they felt there was a big weight on it, on their shoulders, because they had to host it.
Yeah, but I don't remember a single game this year, Glenn, where they came out that flat in the first half, come out of the second half after, you know, Sasho has laid into him, and then give up a quick goal in the first 5 minutes of the second half.
In real control here with a two-goal lead is Georgetown. Brandon Allen winning another ball here. To Newman, who plays it out wide. Rudy keeps it going. The right back, Rosenberry, joining in.
one whipped in again, and boy, just over the head there of Reamer, who was getting into the box from his wide midfield position. Almost won it back. They still look more alive than Maryland here. Down to the sideline to Monica Gonzalez. Monica.
Glenn, I spoke with Coach just a moment, with Brian Wiest, a moment after halftime, and I asked him, how was your team able to come out and play so composed from the very beginning of the game? And he did not hesitate. He said, leadership, our senior leaders. That would be Tommy Muller, Andy Reamer. They came out, they were relaxed, they set the tone for the team, and everyone else followed suit. Glenn.
Thank you, Monica, and boy, we remember Brandon Allen from the opening whistle, too, getting a good chance and throwing himself around with no fear up front. Here again, the outside backs joining into the attack. Nealis now. It's a good touch. Allen on the turn. Allen has gotten turn. Tries to get a shot off Cyrus with some good defending for Maryland. They are winning the individual battles. They are more alive. They're winning the possession game. And they've produced three goals, which they've only done four times this year. Maryland can't even seem to get out here, Taylor. Mullins is now playing as the deeper lying striker.
You know, Newman's going to get the headlines. Brandon Allen, traditionally your goal scorers, but Joey Dillon, I mean, talking to Coach Wiest yesterday, he said if this was an MLS league and there was an expansion draft, the one player he would not lose is Joey Dillon. He's the glue. He's been phenomenal. Every single attempt, Maryland tries to build the ball out of the back. Who's there to break it up? And then it's the simple distribution right afterwards from Dillon. Dillon's been huge.
Brandon Allen will get it switched with that left foot. 16, Jimmy Nealis. Reamer had come inside. And it'll be a free kick to Maryland. They said they were going to try to get a lot of pressure on the ball here today. It has been successful so far up to this point for Georgetown. Mullins, can he bring back the Terrapins? Schumann now, who scored the lone goal for Maryland in the first half via the head.
You know, you're watching this game right now, you wouldn't know Maryland's down 3-1. Lack of urgency going forward, playing two-touch, just really playing very slow.
Schumann now. He's the only one who seemed really switched on at the start of this game for Maryland. Coming up later tonight, 7:30 Eastern here on ESPNU. It's semifinal number two here from Hoover as the Indiana Hoosiers take on the Creighton Blue Jays. The NCAA Men's College Cup presented by Enterprise Rent-A-Car. Semifinal two coming up later tonight at 7:30 right here on ESPNU. Endo has come on for Raley for Maryland. Tsubasa Endo, a very talented player from Japan. Two goals, three assists. In his 20th appearance, so they're hoping he will bring some creative cutting edge here for Maryland to try and get back into this game. Metzger helps it on. Here is Endo. Overhit it, it'll be a goal kick to Georgetown. Thomas Gomez in no rush to restart things here. Again, the clock ticks down in the college game. There is no stoppage time. Schumann trying to keep this play alive. If they could get the next goal in this game, Taylor, Maryland could maybe find that energy and that urgency that they're so lacking right now.
For sure, but now you look at Georgetown keeping their shape, and this is where Coach Weiss, his understudy with Bobby Clark and how sound defensively Stanford was and now Notre Dame is, now this is where your senior leadership comes into play. Now you know you're up 3-1, you hold your ground, you stay in your shape and make life difficult for Maryland.
Second ball has come on the field. By the way, Maryland has only been 2 goals down once this year, and that was in a 4-2 loss to Wake Forest on November 1st. So this is a very unfamiliar position here for the Terrapins.
Well, and that game included a red card as well.
Brendan Allen. Look at this incessant running here from Christensen. Big tackle though from London Woodbury. Timed it perfectly. Sonny Jane. He's got Shuma to his left, Mullins in front of him. Sonny Jane, Shuma, took a touch, fended off a defender, rode the challenge. Maryland building it up, crossing opportunity. Kemp gets it over. Boy, Keith Cardona came flying out at air right there off his line. Tenuous moment for Georgetown. Taylor Kemp is going to let fly, took a deflection. Make that Thomas Gomez in goal for Georgetown, excuse me. Georgetown's road to the College Cup. What a win over Charlotte. Had to go to penalty kicks to get past Syracuse, and we're down 1-0 to San Diego before coming back and scoring 3 goals in that game. They got some huge saves from their goalkeeper, Thomas Gomez. Even Maryland's fans who are below us just have not seemed really emotionally connected to this one. Tsubasa will play a short corner. Kemp, box is loaded up, no pressure on the cross, the header to the back post, Mullen, it's an end, it's 2-2. Yes, it is, it's a good goal. It is now 3-2, so they are back in it. They've gotten the coveted goal that has brought them within one.
When you were talking about it right before this corner kick, that if they could get a goal in the next 15 to 20 minutes, it at least makes it interesting. Well, now you've got 30 minutes. And both goals for Maryland have come from that near post deflection, little touch, and then that second run coming back post, and Mullins does a great job. How often do you see a player come in, try to put that on frame, head it back across the goal, and have someone knock it in?
Shilo Shuma gets his second of the night, his 10th of the season. Was Johnny on the spot, side-footed it in. It is now 3-2. Let's see where the emotional level of this game and the sense of urgency goes for the Maryland Terrapins. And how will Georgetown react to this? Well, goals can just change so much momentum. Here's Taylor Kemp now. And now the Maryland fans are becoming a little bit more vocal and a little bit more involved.
Well, and that's the thing about this Terrapin side is that they have the horses. They have the tools to come back from 2 goals down. It's just, it's getting momentum on your side. And right now, the next 5 minutes, Georgetown has to be extremely careful not giving up that tying goal.
Cyrus tucked in nicely, side-footed it away. Here's Sturzer, who's just such a soccer brain on the ball, number 27 for Maryland. Plays the game with a beautiful simplicity.
And really has had no impact on the game whatsoever. When Maryland is at their best, Sturzer's coming out of the midfield and very dangerous in that final third.
Ellis played it in. Brandon Allen has got that very powerful left foot. And again, boy, again, Allen just wreaking havoc with his movement and runs in the penalty area. Goal kick Maryland, ticking down towards the 30-minute mark. ESPNU has a college basketball Sunday doubleheader. 4 Eastern, Maine taking on Florida State. 6 Eastern, 21-ranked UNLV taking on California. College basketball Sunday on ESPNU, also live on Watch ESPN. And off and running here is Reamer now. Squares it in, it's 4-2. They respond in grand fashion. He's got
Coming into this game, you knew Maryland was going to attack. And then once they got that second goal, they lost a little bit of their composure trying to get this time goal. And they leave holes into the back. They leave some holes and they get caught. It's a great run in from Reamer in behind. Listen, you come into a college game, you dream about a hat trick in the semifinal. That is exactly what Newman has come into this game, shown up. You knew the best player on the field had to be Newman for Georgetown. It's been that man tonight.
Commitment to get into the penalty. Great finish. Got on the end of it. It is the hat trick for Newman. He now has 10 goals on the season, his third tonight. 32, 34th, and 61st minute for Steve Newman. He has led the Big East in assists tonight. He has turned ultra goal scorer with a hat trick. Subasada. Short-lived emotional uplift for Maryland. And we asked the question about a response and we got one. Took only 3 minutes for Georgetown to respond to the Schuma goal that cut it to 3-2. And it is Newman who is slow to get up here in midfield.
Georgetown has just dominated the midfield, in part because Joey Dillon and Christensen have really solidified centrally. They've just been so strong, and particularly when that ball immediately turns over, their first pass has been successful. Where on the other side from Maryland, they've had no rhythm whatsoever building the ball out of the attack. The credit goes to those Dillon and Christensen. Center midfield for Georgetown have been huge.
They continue to try and make it difficult for Maryland to get comfortable in their approach play. Forcing it back. Here's Woodbury now. Subasa. And Maryland will get a free kick here. And time running out on them now as it ticks down towards the 27-minute mark. But as you mentioned, Taylor, it still is a team with a ton of explosive weapons. You can never count Maryland out.
No, you can't, but you just have the feeling the way Georgetown has responded every single time. They go down 1-0. Well, they respond with 3 straight goals. They give up a goal. They respond with their 4th goal. It's just been really Georgetown all night long with how responsive they've been with everything Maryland's trying to throw at them.
Tackled by Allen there. Woodbury coming out of the middle. Not been one of his more dominant performances, London Woodbury, but it has been one of real dominance by Brandon Allen, who has just been an absolute pest and a focal point up front for Georgetown today in support of Steve Newman. Nealis switches the point of attack. Rosenberry, Dillon, good ball towards the corner flag. Is it overhit? It is. It'll be a goal kick to Maryland. NCAA Men's College Cup continues with the national championship Sunday at 2 Eastern on ESPNU. For more tournament coverage and information, log on to NCAA.com, your home for all 89 NCAA championships. We are in Hoover, Alabama, national semifinal number 1. And right now, Georgetown holding a 4-2 lead over Maryland. Steve Newman, a hat trick for the Hoyas, and their head coach, Brian Weiss. Taylor Kemp now for Maryland. Yeah. John Sturzer. Jordan Cyrus. Miss hit the cross. Goes to the back post. And Reamer will knock this one forward and out of play. Another player that has had a very good game, Andy Reamer in midfield. What an engine he is. He's been up and down, two-way midfield play from him. And
well, and versatile, too, because last year he was a center forward. And then when you bring in a freshman like Brandon Allen, well, guess what? When you have an engine like Reamer has, you can find a spot for him on the field. It's been out wide. He's been very strong tonight. And you saw it on the fourth goal, making that late run, catching that offside trap from Maryland. Great ball in. Great goal.
Scored a huge goal, Reamer, too, against San Diego in the quarterfinals. And a good sub off the bench has been Melvin Snow, number 21, who's working the 1-2 here. Melvin Snow now for Georgetown. Long touch, and Woodbury will get there. Still Georgetown. Rosenberry. Reamer back to Rosenberry now. These two have controlled that side of the field nicely here today. Shaking off a tackle. Here's Cristiano Francois. And he tried to bring in Mullins. It's broken up. Taylor, despite the fact that Newman has scored the three goals, this has been a total collective effort here from Georgetown.
No doubt about it. Joey Dillon in the middle. The back four have done a good enough job of containing Patrick Mullins in Maryland. But listen, you score a hat trick in the semifinal, obviously you're going to get the names. But the star for me is the head coach. Brian Weiss has been unbelievable with his game plan and really put Maryland on their heels.
Nealis now. Speaking of putting them on their heels, he's been doing it all night long. Nealis has just been joining in on this left side consistently. Tsubasa coming over to try and help out for Maryland. Changes now. Padilla coming in for Allen. Pace for Shuma. Two different types of strikers exchanging there. Shuma with the pace, who's got the two goals for Maryland. Pace, who is a big body and will throw himself around.
And Padilla came in. He came in against San Diego, and you heard Coach talk about it. He played a solid 12 to 13 minutes when they needed it. They needed to give Allen a break. They brought in Padilla to run up there, be strong, just cause some havoc. Look for him to do that as well.
Sturzer. Taylor Kemp. He's gotten forward a little bit, but really has not gotten in behind Georgetown from a wide position, and very rarely has Jordan Cyrus. They have not penetrated. Melvin Snow knocks it back. 18 is Newman, the hat trick hero for the moment. Rare giveaway because Georgetown has been very, very careful and smart with the ball today.
But then what's their reaction? Reamer immediately comes in, steals the ball from Pace, and puts Maryland under pressure again.
Here's Snow trying to apply some pressure. Tsubasa now for Maryland. Taylor Kemp generally gets to about that area and is held up. Good work from Padilla, who comes back. He's going to get called for the foul, though. Free kick to Maryland. Driven in. Tsubasa. And down at the top of the box. And free kick's going to be given to Georgetown. Maryland might have thought they had one prior. Well, he's been a hero today, Steve Newman. And it starts for him in the 32nd minute.
Yeah, early on, you saw him create a couple chances, but he wasn't ready. Nerves may have been on his side, hit the ball over the top, and then all of a sudden he gets on fire, finding that half a yard inside the 18. Great second goal. And then I love the third goal, because that is who he is as a player, making that run as a second forward. Great finish. It's been a phenomenal game from Newman, getting on the end of things for Georgetown.
10 goals on the season, also a setup man tonight. He has turned into the ultra goal scorer in the biggest game of the year. Tsubasa now for Maryland. Ticking down towards the 19-minute mark. Pace trying to put some pressure on. Ironically, in this game, the four goals for Georgetown is a season high. Tells you about living up to the moment. We heard Brian Weiss say there's more goals in this game.
Yeah, I mean, there's still 19 minutes left in this game. And you just, the way Maryland's going to push numbers forward, if Georgetown is very composed with their shape, they can catch them on the counter.
Cardona. Christensen. What an effort there just to keep that alive and not concede the throw-in. From Rosenberry, only a freshman who's been a wonderful surprise for the head coach, Brian Weiss. Padilla won it back. So there's your sub doing the work.
Tell you one thing, watching this game, you would not know that Seiler and Rosenberry were freshmen for the Hoyas.
Over the top. Long range hit there, an effort from Nealis, who was joining in the attack. The Elite 89 is presented to the student athlete with the highest cumulative grade point average participating in the finals for each of the NCAA's 89 championships. The recipient of the 89 award for the 2012 Men's College Cup with a cumulative grade point of 3.827 in biology, Keon Parsa, a junior at Georgetown University. Congratulations to Keon. Mikey Ambrose now has come on for Jordan Cyrus.
3.8 GPA, huh? Yeah.
At Georgetown? I mean, we might be working for him one day.
I don't think it's a might.
Padilla. Up to this point, this game has been controlled by Georgetown. London Woodbury now. Driven into the box, Pace was in there. Here's Mikey Ambrose now, just fresh off the bench for Maryland. Freshman out of Frisco, Texas. Let's go, left footed shot, off the crossbar and headed in. The substitute makes a difference. Mullins headed it in. After a long range bomb from Mikey Ambrose, the entertainment continues here in Hoover.
So how's that for your first touch? You come in, substitute at right back, a freshman, first College Cup, sure, why not? I mean, you watch Ambrose just come into this game, first touch, okay, I'm gonna set you up and I'm gonna hit an absolute screamer. No chance for Gomez whatsoever, net ball was moving. And again, Mullins there, it's a little thing. That's how you score 16 goals in a season. Following up, being in the right spot at the right time, that shot was unbelievable.
He reacted first, Mullins. So now, again, Maryland has an opportunity now to see if they can jumpstart their game, find their game here in the final 16-plus minutes. 17th of the year for Patrick Mullins, one of the most outstanding strikers and attacking players in the nation. Aided by that man, number 5, Mikey Ambrose, fresh off the bench.
You got to be kidding me with that strike, Glenn.
Pace. Is Pace in? Gomez dives at his feet, makes a huge play. Tomas Gomez coming up with a goalkeeping gem for Georgetown. Yeah.
No one would have predicted a seven-goal thriller here in this first semifinal. Reimer knocks it back. Christensen. Rosenberry. Reimer knocks it back towards the halfway line now. 4-3 Georgetown lead here. Great goalkeeper.
Well, and he was a little reluctant coming out. You saw him take a little bit of a stutter step, which allowed Pace to make that more of a play than it should have been.
Georgetown free kick now. Newman will take it. He will swing it in. It's headed away by Tsubasa, who's going to win the second ball. Those second and third balls so vital. Georgetown scrapping away, trying to win it back, and they do through Padilla. Well, again, as you mentioned, has provided the minutes, Taylor.
Yeah, but at this point now, if you're Coach Reese, you bring on Brandon Allen. He's gotten enough rest that now at this point, you got 14 minutes left in this game. He has to come on.
And he's standing waiting to come on right down on the sideline. So they got their minutes out of Padilla. Here's Padilla again, pressing, harassing. Tsubasa comes out of there from Tokyo, Japan. Woodbury. He's only a freshman, but he's played bigger than that today. Brandon Allen.
Well, all three freshmen from Georgetown.
Not to mention Mikey Ambrose, a freshman for Maryland, who comes off the bench. Smashes one off the crossbar, and Patrick Mullins heads it in to keep them in a game that maybe they shouldn't even be in at this point. Here is Ambrose. Woodbury.
And on the other side for Maryland, Schumann's not on the field. He must come in now. He's been active. He needs to come on the field and do something dangerous.
Christian Francois, the Haitian. The Haitian gets a shot. He's tied it up. Maryland has somehow tied this game up. What an unbelievable comeback. Christian Francois has picked out the side netting.
And all season long, Francois has been the first guy off the bench. He's got 4 goals, 4 assists, but only 3 starts, and he's been that dynamic player for Sasha Sarovsky off the bench here, and just absolutely takes on 2-3 players. That's an unbelievable goal. An unbelievable goal. And what happened, Georgetown was bringing 8-9 players in behind. Francois said, nope, I'm going to take this upon myself, take players on, and make something happen. 4-4? What a game.
Reimer now trying to cut into the box. Stunning. Schuma is back on for Maryland. Tsubasa switches it to Ambrose with some good vision. Ambrose. It's a decent looking cross. Nobody at the back post. It was only Tsubasa in there amongst the Georgetown defenders.
Listen, Ambrose is coming in. He's going to cut inside to that left foot. Nealis and Georgetown have to do a better recognition that when Ambrose pushes forward, force him down the flank or force him direct. Don't allow him to step you up, take you 1-on-1, and deliver a good ball in with that left foot.
Francois has gotten turned again, provided a magical moment, a play to bring Maryland back to a tie. Francois at the top of the box. Sturzer. Francois over the top. They broke him down with combination play. But it is the Haitian who is bringing Maryland back in this one.
Oh, and Francois has come into this game, particularly the second half, and been a game changer. Running off the ball quick. I mean, he's in tight. He does all the hard work. Except the finish. And you saw his finish. His finish was inside the foot, back post. That's what he needed right there. No reason to try to roof this as hard as he can. Good run. Maryland's putting pressure on Georgetown right now.
They're in their best phase of soccer over the course of this evening. It's coming as the clock ticks down towards the 11-minute mark. Tsubasa's Ambrose. Francois's in there, headed away. Schuma gets knocked off it. And now all of a sudden Maryland trying to apply higher pressure, feeling that there's a fifth goal in their game. Cardona off his line for Maryland.
I mean, this just goes to show you how good this Maryland team is. Georgetown has dominated 80% of this game. Scoreline's 4-4.
Playmakers?
I think playmakers, game changers, and just how efficient they are in that final third.
Yeah, they've got so many individuals that can make a play to bring you back in the game. It's not one or two players, it's four or five, six. And Maryland fans are back in it now. They've been kept pretty silent here the entire evening. Snow. Miss hit the cross. Had a wonderful opportunity, unpressured, unforced error. Had players getting into the penalty area, Melvin Snow. Cyrus comes on, and the man who's led them back coming off for Maryland right now is going to get a heck of a round of applause. Cristiano Francois. Base. Offside flag is up on Schuma. Excuse me, that was Jordan Cyrus making that run forward. Woodbury now comes out of the middle for Maryland. Schuma. Schuma. Is he gone? Schuma. Still Schuma, and he puts back inside into a defender who recovers. Seiler getting back in there.
Tackle from Mueller, though. I mean, very few players, very few defenders are going to keep up with Schuma. Seiler gets beat, but Mueller sliding over. Great play.
Melvin Snow. Allen goes to ground, keeps it alive. 16 is Nealis. Crossing opportunity. Good looking cross from Nealis.
Great looking ball.
Wow. Had some movement in it as well. Allen at the top of the box, trying to get turned, was Rudy, number 13 for Georgetown. And it'll be a Maryland free kick. Mullins is down, taking the brunt of that tackle.
I mean, this game has everything you want. It's got eight goals, it's got mistakes, it's got players scoring hat tricks. This game has absolutely had everything you want. But over the last 5 or 6 minutes, you have to wonder if the Georgetown players, Glenn, that thought's creeping in your mind. You score 4 goals against Maryland, you have them on the ropes, yet now you're still 4-4. You know, where does that experience come into play for Georgetown? Who does that come from?
Mueller knocks it forward. Cardona. Is there a goal in the final 7 minutes and 12 seconds?
I'm sure
in this semifinal.
There's already eight.
We are set up for drama here. Woodbury tries to get it clear. Jordan Cyrus now. He's got Schuman in front of him. Off and running is Mullins. Mullins has got it. One of the tops in the nation. Mullins. His touch was too long, but it's going to earn Maryland a corner. As we count down towards 6 minutes.
It's this game has just opened up this second half, particularly for Maryland, and in part because their outside back Cyrus Taylor Kemp have gotten forward and allowed Mullins to find those channels outside the 18.
Tsubasa off the corner. Cyrus brought it down amazingly. Just absolutely killed that ball like a bag of cement. Ambrose. Maryland throwing everybody forward here. A line of four players against the back line of Georgetown here as they're simply going for it. Mullins trying to get there. Cleared away by Rosenberry, the freshman. Georgetown going to try and get Reamer back on, so Snow will come off. Down to Monica Gonzalez. Monica?
Glenn, when I talked to Coach Sarovsky yesterday, he said the biggest advantage his team has is depth. He feels like he has two top 20 teams on his roster, and the constant stream of subs they've had so far this half has taken its toll on Georgetown.
Shuma now getting into the box. Shuma shot to the deflection. And a huge save from Thomas Gomez going to his left.
When numbers are coming at you, you have to come up big with that save. You've already given up four goals. You still have to stay focused. Gomez does a wonderful job of keeping that near post away.
Taylor Kemp delivers towards the near post. The prerequisite to beat that first defender, it doesn't. Throw into Maryland. Ticking down towards the 4 minute mark here. At stake, a trip to the national championship. It is 4-4. Woodbury gets up. Ambrose sees it out. Here's Ambrose, quick throw now. Metzger got closed down quickly there by Christensen. Him and Dylan have done that diligent work in midfield. Mullins lays it off. Saving play again, cleared by Seiler.
They have, but the last 15 to 20 minutes, Glenn, Dylan Christensen, they're exhausted, defending consistently with the numbers Maryland has pushed forward. This game has completely changed here in the last 5 minutes.
Mullins lays it off. Patrick Mullins over the top. Didn't even need a run up to it. It was almost like he hit it off a standing foot.
Well, and I love this aspect about Patrick Mullins, because we saw this a couple times in the first half. He needs a half a yard. You know, Newman has scored a couple goals tonight without any run up, without any build up, just simply having good technique, putting it on frame. Mullins has been the same.
Georgetown now. Newman clips it over the top. Reamer was the target. Extremely dangerous. Turned the Maryland defense.
Little touch from Leichvang. Save that.
Runners in front of the ball for Patrick Mullins. Cyrus is pushed forward. Shuma, who's got two goals. Metzger's cross is blocked. Another corner for Maryland. Ticking down towards the 2 minute mark.
Well, on the change of Mikey Ambrose at right back has pushed Jordan Cyrus forward at right midfield. Traditionally an outside defender, but in high school he scored 122 goals as a center forward. He's come into this game, and it's allowed Shuma and Mullins to be their center forwards and run those channels.
Now Cyrus is going to come off, and look what Sasha Sarovsky is doing. He's bringing on a big man here, Pace, to try to get on the end of this corner. Cyrus helped turn this game around. They get it over. Up they go. Ball still loose. Pouncing on it is Gomez. Pace was in the middle of it all.
Felt like bringing on a substitute and having that one touch. mean, Pace came in, the ball was sitting there. Gomez comes up huge. Now if you're Georgetown, you see this game out, you make sure you play for overtime. And if you're Maryland, listen, you've got Georgetown on your heels. Why not try to end this game here quickly?
Woodbury gets up. Woodbury gets up again. Metzger knocks it forward. Pace. Sturts are involved there. Clock being held now here. He will pick up a yellow card. And straight leg, maybe that's the reason why he picks up the yellow. It's been a hard fought game, but one tonight where we haven't seen that many fouls, to be honest with you. It's been one that has exceeded expectations in some ways with the 8 goals here. And we could be headed to overtime, or maybe not. Cardona's going to have to make a play here. Still a minute left in this one. Still time for a goal, but 2 10-minute overtime periods. Golden goal would be an effective. Still tied. Penalties. Schumer now trying to go for the win here for Maryland. Schumer. Pace gets it off and just wide. Schumer set up Pace.
I mean, they just come at you at waves, Glenn.
It will be a corner for Maryland.
Maryland just throwing numbers. I mean, it's amazing that they haven't found that fifth goal.
They may find it here. They're trying to get it here with 27 seconds left. And it's a miss-hit corner. It will be one they lament. They didn't give him a chance. Georgetown now. There's only 10 seconds left. They're going to stick it in towards the box. Tsubasa missed it. Left-footed shot from Allen is on target, but held by Cardona. So we will get entertainment to the end of this one.
Wow, what a game.
What an advertisement for college soccer in many ways here tonight. It is 4-4 after regulation. Here's how it ends.
I'll tell you one thing. I could just sit here and clap, Glenn. This has been an absolute unbelievable semifinal. It's had everything. And imagine a game-saving goal at the end. Woo! There's still more to this game?
There is. Don't go anywhere. 2 10-minute overtime periods. The golden goal will be in effect. If it's still tied, it's on the penalties. Georgetown 4, Maryland 4.
Whether I'm right or whether I'm wrong, gotta be me.
I love to play football because it just gives you the opportunity to go out there with your friends and excite all the fans day in and day out. Family, it sounds corny, but, and I know that's what we use when we're recruiting people, is that we're family, but it really is. I chose a school that I wanted to go to based on how comfortable I felt there. I wanted a school where I'd feel comfortable and where everyone's loved me still for who I am, and that's what I got when I found Auburn.
At Cobalt, we work with innovative tools every day. So something needs to be really exceptional to get us excited. And that something is this, the Cobalt Double Drive. It may look like an ordinary screwdriver, but when you hold this collar, it engages the double drive. So while you turn the handle forward and backward, the bits keep on moving. And because they keep on moving, it drives screws twice as fast as a ratcheting driver. And now there's a double drive for precision driving. The same dual drive gearing mechanism and size for the precision screws you find on electronics, computers, and even toys.
Double drive works just like a ratcheting driver,
until you hold the collar, and double drive doubles your speed and reverses direction with a flip of a switch. Double drive is great for electricians, plumbers, and contractors, and it's great as a gift. Buy your double drive today to get both the standard and precision drivers, along with standard and precision bits. And when you buy online or by phone, you'll get two extenders and a holster that stores your entire double drive set, exclusively at Lowe's.
The NCAA Men's College Cup is presented by Enterprise Rent-A-Car. We'll pick you up. And in part by AT&T. Rethink possible. And Ram Trucks. Guts. Glory. Ram.
Welcome back to Hoover, Alabama. A stunning game here tonight. Maryland 4, Georgetown 4, as we're getting sent for overtime here in the first of two NCAA's Men's College Cup. And semifinal here, and here's the goals that Maryland produced on the night.
Yeah, and it really was a tale of two halves, because the second half, they had to answer Georgetown, down 3-1, and they did. I mean, what a strike from Mikey Ambrose to come in. Mullins in the right spot of the red time. Francois with a great finish. I mean, this game has had it all. I mean, you look at Maryland with four great goals. Georgetown has been something special. What a game.
Francois, give him a lot of credit. He led the charge back. But here is the goal summary here. Schuma in the 20th. That was against the run of play. Then Steve Newman took over, scoring twice within 2 minutes. Brandon Allen then made it 3-1. Things looking great for Georgetown. Schuma scores, cuts it to 3-2. You think, okay, Maryland's coming back. Tremendous responses. Newman hits for the hat trick. And you think, is that going to keep Maryland down? No, it's not. 73 and 77, Mullins and Francois, and we are tied at 4. Overtime rules, again, two 10-minute overtime periods. That wonderful golden goal, in effect, is still tied on the penalty kicks. Please don't send me emails and texts about calling it extra time, because in the college game, it is overtime.
And this is a game of momentum right now, Glenn. And when you look at it, the momentum was on Georgetown's side all game long, particularly because of this man, Steve Newman. I mean, great finishes, great technique. I mean, a half a yard looking for that spot, good finishes. But then you look at how they kind of reacted, and Maryland took over this game. Maryland went into overtime now with all the momentum. Can Steve Newman now come into this overtime and have an impact? That'll be key for Georgetown.
Yeah, they've got to wrestle it back now, because Newman's big effort of three goals here tonight, hitting the penalty spot there. Well, for right now, the next goal is the biggest goal. Georgetown in blue, Maryland in white. Trip to the national championship at stake here. First overtime period is underway. Again, it is a golden goal. You score, it's over. Blakevang will go direct. It's over the top. Schuma may have a step on a defender here. Swenswall trying to get in. And it'll be a goal kick to Georgetown, as Maryland going very, very direct here in the first seconds of the first overtime session.
Well, now look at their two front runners, Francois, and it's Schuma now up front. Mullins is now into the midfield. You think Sasha Swarovski doesn't sense that Georgetown's on their heels? He's putting their speed up front, now having Mullins be that third attacker out of the midfield. Maryland's coming out and trying to put Georgetown on their heels right away.
Metzger. Ambrose.
Put away by Mueller.
Brandon Allen up front. Number 10, the freshman. 16 goals for Georgetown. Could he be the star here tonight? Mullins now trying to pounce on this. Mullins nearly getting it. Off his line, Thomas Gomez. Woodbury heads it away. Here's Sturzer now. Reamer, who's been outstanding, number 20 for Georgetown, trying to break in behind Taylor Kemp to Cardona. Slightest of headers there, trying to put in Francois, who
just has blazing pace and has been jet fueled since he has come into this game. Elis trying to get forward. Here's what Georgetown is 4-1-2 in overtime this season. And Maryland 2-0-2. Mullins. Francois. He's got room to run at the defense. He's off and running. Francois. Looks for support, holds it up. Finds it with Sturzer, who knocks it to Taylor Kemp now. Kemp will bend it in. Francois is in there. John Snyder, 22, has come into midfield for Georgetown. Here is Georgetown. Offside flag is up. Melvin Snow trying to make that angled run. Far side of the field. Keep going back to the fact that Georgetown in 28 matches in history against Maryland have not produced a win. I'm still shaking my head that Maryland got back to this game.
Easily one of the greatest games I've ever been a part of. Very fortunate to be here. Two teams going at it. You look at the players on the field. You got players cramping, players hands on their knees looking for every grasp of air, but what a game. Now it's how far can you dig in, and this is where you have to think that the depth of Maryland will outshine Georgetown.
You also got to credit Georgetown just for the mental strength here, because in my opinion they dominated 80-85% of this game. Had a bad period where a team of playmakers came up with plays and brought themselves back into this game. Well, right after this one, it's Indiana and Creighton. That's coming up next on ESPNU. That's if we can still breathe after this game, because this has been just a spectacular opening game, and Indiana and Creighton are going to have a lot to live up to in the entertainment category, that is for sure, but that will be another great one. And there is a look at Creighton in the crowd here. They're all observing this as well. And what's that do for the two teams that are watching here at this point, Taylor?
Well, it throws your rhythm off. Preparing for a game, you expect the game to start at one time. It'll be very interesting who starts hotter in that second game, because right now your rhythm's off.
Good ball over the top. He is onside. This would be for the win. Allen is open in the box, and it's blocked by Leichvang. Allen had a step on London Woodbury.
For the first time tonight, we saw Newman make the wrong decision.
Melvin Snow now, number 21 for Georgetown. Slippery striker, plays it into the box, Brandon Allen. They get it out wide. Nealis. Christensen lost it. Space in midfield for Francois if he can get opened up here. Some excellent work from John Snyder just not to commit in the tackle there, number 22 for Georgetown. It's broken up by Pace. John Sturzer. Taylor Kemp now for Maryland. Again, first goal wins it. Mullins. Put it through the legs of a player. Patrick Mullins squares it back in. Pace lays it off. Francois. Pace. Shot it off the side netting. How quick it happens for Maryland.
And it's from all angles. In the start of this overtime, Sasha Sarovsky has moved Patrick Mullins to left midfield. Taking on Rosenberry. Good ball in. I love that touch from Pace.
And Franzau does enough, but it's just the waves of attackers they come at you. Think of that. There are two center forwards right now started this game on the bench in Pace and Francois.
And that man, Patrick Mullins, playing in a variety of roles here tonight that you've aptly pointed out. Here is Mullins again, deeper, playing provider towards Pace. Like Vang steps up. Woodbury. Soft, feathery control there from him. Kemp under pressure now. Kemp fights through it. Rayleigh, Pace. Francois in there. So is Rayleigh. Lays it back. Mullins, this is the man you want on the ball here. Bends it in. Clear. Sturzer couldn't get there. Brandon Allen now for Georgetown. Can they break out? Allen with a wonderful ball out wide. This is the hat trick hero, Newman. And that will earn Georgetown a corner and a chance to try and win it here off a set piece. Seiler comes on for Snyder now. Elvin Snow has come over for the short one. You can bet it won't be that. And it comes. Reamer got a head on it, but it goes way over the top. Remains 4-4. First overtime session here, counting down towards the 3-minute mark. Remains tied. We go on to another 10-minute overtime session. Still tied. It's on the penalty kicks. There's drama in store here. Tyler Rudy coming on for Georgetown. Reamer gets a break. Woodbury. Tremendous aerial battle there with Pace. Rayleigh now. Francois is the target. Second ball, who's going to pick it up? Francois. Rayleigh. Sturzer for Maryland plays it wide. Ambrose had that vital shot off the crossbar that Mullins knotted in.
Is that what we're calling it? It's just a shot?
How about a rocket? Yeah, that was smashed off the crossbar. Has it become a little bit more calculated now?
Well, it's human nature. Now you're in overtime, knowing that a golden goal wins the game, that now you don't take as many chances as a player. You're sitting on the field, that penalty kicks start creeping in the back of your mind. You don't want to make mistakes, but Maryland this overtime has been much more proactive in the final third of putting pressure on Georgetown than vice versa.
Good switch of play from Christensen. Nealis driving into the attack with that left foot. He's been exceptional out there. Nealis towards the end line. He's going to try and square this back. It took a deflection to Cardona at the near post. Nobody got across the face of that near post. Nealis has been outstanding as well, getting forward. Francois, Mullins next to him. Pace is hitting the far post. Sturzer. Mullins holds the player off. Mullins tries to get turn, swings it air, goes down, clutching his leg, shot to save at the near post. Gomez denied Francois. The art of flying and goal there. Stunning save.
Tell you, this freshman has been fun to watch tonight. Francois just know his instincts. Phenomenal taking players one-on-one. I mean, look at that hit.
That is an unbelievable save from Gomez near post. But Francois come in, not shown any inexperience whatsoever. Very composed in that final third.
And he helped lead the charge to turn the tide and the urgency in this game.
Great save from Gomez near post. That ball was moving.
Spectacular sequence. Off the corner, a goal here and it's over. There's 14 seconds left to the back post. Then Gomez has to pick it out of the sky. That'll do it. First overtime session here. First overtime session is over here. We will go on to a second 10-minute overtime session. Again, Georgetown, Maryland, up next, Indiana and Creighton, right here on ESPNU, and then Sunday at 2 o'clock Eastern on ESPNU. It is the championship. Take a look at the goal summary here. 8 goals in this one, Taylor. It's been an unbelievable night here in Hoover.
And now it comes down just to the second overtime. And now as a player, I've been in these situations. You don't want to be that player that makes the mistake. But then as that center forward, oftentimes you got to be creative. You got to take something, create something out of nothing, one-on-one. And then you get that one chance, hopefully bury it. This game should not end on penalty kicks. With how exciting this game, it deserves a winner in overtime.
Let's go down to the third member of our team, Monica Gonzalez.
Glenn, well, Andy Reimer came off the field holding his hamstring. He got stretched by the trainer, his hamstring, tried to get back up, took only a couple of steps and fell back to the ground, was getting stretched again. Only just moments ago, stood up and tried to walk for the first time. Andy Reimer is one of the top 3 goal scorers on this Georgetown team. Glenn, back to you.
Thank you, Monica, and he has done an inordinate amount of running here tonight. He's been spelled a couple of times by Coach Brian Weiss. All right, so if you're Brian Weiss, and it's a, you know, it's a stunning comeback here from Maryland. What's he saying to his team right now in the huddle?
Well, you can see it right there. You see his mannerisms. He's being extremely positive. Now, as a head coach, you're just trying to get the players to reach down deep and find that little bit of extra that they have. Again, though, who has the depth? That's Maryland. And coming into this set overtime, you just had the feeling. You look at Newman, you look at the Georgetown players. They're gassed. They've given everything they had. Maryland now has the tools and the horses to put some pressure on them.
And they had the tools and the horses to get back into this one. Where over the course of 90 minutes, you had to say Georgetown was the better team. And here's the Maryland fans certainly trying to figure out the dynamics of trying to boost their team to a victory here. Second overtime session is underway. Glenn Davis alongside Taylor Twellman, Monica Gonzalez on the sideline here on ESPNU here in Hoover, Alabama. Newman shot over the top. Going for a fourth was Steve Newman. Good power on it, but couldn't put it on frame.
I could watch Steve Newman play all night long. And it's not because he's had a hat trick tonight. Of course, that's part of the reason, but it's his understanding of where to find those seams in those pockets in front of the back four of Maryland. He's an absolute nightmare to track defensively because he makes you decide as a center back, do I come off my line and track into the midfield? And then it opens up channels in behind for Brandon Allen and other forwards from Georgetown to get in behind.
Francois trying to get in behind right now. Defended well. He has had a solid game. Tommy Muller. Player that MLS likely would be interested in. Solid center back. Christensen, player down on the sideline here for Georgetown, right in front of the Maryland bench.
I'm pretty sure MLS scouts are watching this game and they have about 10 to 11 names written down.
Headed away by Ambrose.
Golden Goal will win it if we're still tied here after 8 minutes and change. It is on to penalty kicks. Muller, Reamer, who Monica mentioned was struggling to keep going here. A lot of this is fighting through the barrier fatigue right now. Ambrose now off the throne. There's a good look at Brian Weiss trying to engineer the first ever win for Georgetown over Maryland. It would send them to a national championship. Kemp now. He's found space, has picked his head up. We'll get the cross in. And it's miss it. It's the wrong area, picked off by Thomas Gomez. Leichfang will just whack it into the Georgetown half of the field, ticking down towards the 6 minute mark. Woodbury, Schuma. Metzger, Leichvang, Taylor Kemp. Split two. Kemp now is continuing his run forward. He'll get it wide. Mullins bends in across, headed out. Good defensive header there. From once again, Tommy Muller.
I mean, I don't mind Mullins finding the left seam, playing the left flank and looking for some space, but he needs to be in the box getting on the end of those crosses.
Melvin Snow over the top. Woodbury. Left-footed shot. There was a whistle. It'll be a free kick to Maryland. Bit of a dangerous moment there, because it was Newman making that run.
And just running those channels. And I just, the timing of the runs, and Woodbury's been much better. He had a nervy start, very nervy start, getting over the flu, but he's been better. But Newman just running those channels, he's always looking for that seam.
Good point on Woodbury. He has grown as the game has gone on. He's having to come out of the middle a bit more now. Here's Allen, the freshman. Holds it up. He's got a good left foot trying to drive along the end line. He ran it out of play. It'll be a goal kick to Maryland. Cyrus coming back on now for Schuma. You can see the utter fatigue on the faces of players now.
I mean, they've given everything they've had, both teams.
Woodbury. Cyrus took it off his chest. Good work from Georgetown. They win it back.
Nealis has been very good tonight.
Exceptional. Got stripped. Metzger. Nealis still battling to win it back and concedes the free kick. Maybe a tough call there on Jimmy Nealis. Jordan Cyrus.
Ambrose to take the throw. Is there a goal here in the final 3 minutes and 4 seconds? Ambrose towards the near post. That's a dangerous ball. It's a chance here. No call from Penso. Maryland saying potentially a penalty. It almost was over.
This cannot be how this game would have ended. I mean, good ball in from Ambrose. It's the initial clearance from Muller, but right off of Seiler. And Gomez, just that little touch on Mullins throws him off guard. Gotta be kidding me.
Gomez off the goal kick, headed forward by Snow, cleared by Woodbury. Good battling work by Joey Dillon in midfield. Oh, the foul. Kemp draped all over Reamer, the captain. Tsubasa, still a minute and 45 seconds left. Tsubasa, he's got Cyrus in the box as well as Mullins. And it's cleared by Georgetown. Francois. Ambrose has got that powerful left foot. Sturzer switches it. Taylor Kemp, crossing opportunity. 4 or 5 players in the box for Maryland. It's headed away. Second ball now picked up by Ambrose. Maryland trying to find a final goal here. Ambrose flag is up, and it'll be a free kick to Georgetown.
When you look at it, Sasha, I'm not so sure what game Sasha's watching, because that's 100% a foul on Ambrose.
Rudy jumping back on for Reamer now. There's Sasha Surovsky.
Oh, and there's, you love the passion on the sideline from Sasha Surovsky, but that's a foul.
He's going to get a yellow card for it, too. Certainly highly competitive, highly emotional, passionate.
And as much of credit we gave to Georgetown in that first half, you'd be remiss not to talk about what University of Maryland has done tonight. The resiliency they've shown to come back, the amount of times they have tonight, and stay into this game, and looks like this game will be going to penalty kicks.
8 combined goals tonight. Third most combined goals in a College Cup game. There was 10 when St. Louis played Maryland way, way back in the 60s. 20 seconds left. Allen. Tsubasa's going to stick it forward. It is on to penalty kicks. It ends 4-4 after 2 overtime sessions. Sasha Surovsky has engineered a comeback here for Maryland on a day where Georgetown may have said, Taylor, they played the better soccer.
What a great game. Unbelievable game. 8 goals, but now going into penalty kicks, you look at the stats. Georgetown as a team, 0-for-3 this year at penalty kicks. Maryland, Sturzer took all 3 of them. Where's the confidence? Where's the momentum switch here? It's been all Maryland in that overtime. Which keeper shows up as well? Those are the storylines going into penalty kicks.
Let's take a look back at the Maryland goals, and they've been chasing this game apart from getting the first one here against the run of the play from Schuma.
Yeah, and it was all Georgetown in that first half, but Schuma and Mullins just active and very efficient in that final third. Ambrose comes into the game with an absolute rocket with his first touch. And then Francois, what a great finish. Takes on 2-3 defenders, finds that back post. Maryland came back, and you got to give him credit.
How vivid was that image of Francois? There was such a small window there to sneak that in the post. And then here's this goal summary from the night. Unbelievable.
Well, and Francois, right after that goal he scored, he had a wonderful opportunity 6 yards out and hit it over the net. But what a game. 8 goals. What else are you going to say?
8 goals in 77 minutes. So an unbelievable run of goals here. And the rules and the penalties, best of five. If still tied after five, we're going to call it a sudden victory. And it will be one that's devastating for one team and one that's joyous for another. Len Davis and Taylor Twellman here in Hoover, and we've just
I'm exhausted.
We've witnessed an 8-goal fest here, and okay, psychologically now, who's got the edge going into penalty kicks?
Well, now it's even, really, but I look at it when you're as a whole season long, you've been 0-for-3 as a team, as Georgetown has. You want to make sure your first couple hit the back of the net. If you start out the penalty kick round hitting a couple over, or Cardona makes some saves, then you're in trouble. So right now, those first couple penalty kicks are huge.
And we know John Sturzer's 3-for-3, so we're going to assume John Sturzer's going to hit his.
I'm pretty sure he's going to take one.
And it's going to come up to some people who have not been to the penalty spot here, though, to produce this year. And who's got the edge in goal here? Is it Keith Cardona from Maryland or Thomas Gomez for Georgetown?
And they're taking these penalty kicks on the baseball infield side. And I walked the field this morning, Glenn, and right where the penalty spot is, there's new sod. And so the players weren't allowed, the teams were not allowed to train on this field yesterday. And often before a semifinal or a cup final, you want to train on the field, find the certain spots on the field. It'd be very interesting to see. There's a little lift right where the penalty spot is. It's going to be very difficult to keep the ball down underneath the bar.
The winner of this game after penalties will take on the winner of Indiana Creighton, which is up next. And of course, that'll be Sunday 2 Eastern time on ESPNU. So much drama here to finish this one off tonight. Young goalkeeper, what goes through the mind of Keith Cardona, a sophomore. Had a rough moment in the second half, got caught with the ball at his feet. Got caught in possession by Brandon Allen. That made the score 3-1. Somehow Maryland came back in this one. Cardona now with a 1.02 goals against average throughout the year. Will have to go up against Steve Newman, who hit for a hat trick over the course of 90 minutes. So Georgetown going first. Newman against Cardona. Slow approach, slots it home, ice cold finish.
Are you surprised? First College Cup semifinal, score a hat trick, step up, take the first penalty kick with the weight of Georgetown on your shoulders. Nice, easy run up. Get Cardona going the wrong way. Good penalty.
So now Sasho Sarovsky does what he thinks is best, and that is I'm putting my best penalty taker up right away. He's going to be my first shooter here. John Sturzer was 3-for-3 during the course of the college season. And he is 4-for-4, and that's why. Absolutely wonderful penalty from
John
Sturzer.
No doubt about that one. Picks his spot, already knows where he's going. Head down, good technique. No brainer.
1-1. Into round two we go. Tommy Muller, who was outstanding at center back, against Cardona. Save Cardona, going to his right. Maryland now with a chance to take a lead.
Muller gives it away too soon. Opens up that hip and you see it, and it's a good penalty. That's going inside the post, but it's that half a yard right before he hits it. easy read for Cardona. Good save.
Yeah, the position of people's hips or his approach revealed something there. Give it to Cardona. Schumann now, who had two goals over the course of the game tonight for Maryland. Puts him up 2-1 after two rounds. Make that London Woodbury. So London Woodbury, the center back, hitting for Maryland.
Very impressive from Woodbury, Glenn. You just never see center backs as composed as he is on the ball.
Ian Christensen now
steps up and buries it.
Against Cardona. Christensen scores.
Woo.
Big penalty. Puts the pressure back on Maryland here to keep their lead.
That's three penalty kicks in a row that Cardona's jumped a little early and guessed and gone to his right. That's way soon. Cardona's moving way too early, and Christensen picks it up and simply just puts it down the middle.
Mullins. You would expect him to make his penalty. He does. He goes with pure power upstairs.
Oh, there's not a goalkeeper in the world that's going to get that one. No doubt about this one. Step up, pace, roof of the net. That's a great penalty.
Andy Reimer stepping up now. Remember the report from Monica Gonzalez saying he was exhausted. So we'll see if fatigue has anything to do with this penalty he's about to take. Reimer had an outstanding game. Shot the goal. What a goal from Reimer. Took his penalty beautifully.
This is a great penalty. Why? Because Cardona now stays, holds his ground, and he reads Reimer. Reimer opens up these hips. He has you thinking he's going that other post. That's a good penalty.
Taylor Kemp now. If he converts, keeps Maryland in the lead at 4-3 here. Kemp. By Gomez. We are all tied up after four rounds.
Well, and you just saw the penalty kick from Reimer, and he opens up the hips the same way Taylor Kemp does, but he goes the other way. This time, Taylor Kemp opens up his hips. He tells Gomez exactly where he's going. It's an easy save.
Huge for Thomas Gomez. And this man, Jimmy Nielsen, Nielis has been outstanding throughout this game here tonight on the left side, getting into the attack for Georgetown. And now he has the importance of taking this penalty and putting the pressure back on Maryland. Nielis does. Maryland has to score here.
Well, in the regular season, Georgetown was 0-3 on penalty kicks. Well, they beat Syracuse on penalty kicks, right? And they've shown the composure in this round. Listen, their reaction all game long, whether it's in penalties or in the regulation of the game, they've been strong.
Helge Leikvang from Oslo, Norway, will step up to the penalty spot. Did not start tonight for Maryland. Has to score here to keep things tied. If not, Georgetown advances. Leikvang, save, it's over! Georgetown will go to the NCAA College Cup Final. Gomez has made the save. And you may not catch him. What a moment for the Georgetown Hoyas. For the first time ever, go to the College Cup Championship game. They have knocked off Maryland in penalty kicks.
Well, they had to defeat Syracuse and penalties, and they've done the exact same thing, and it's just been their reaction all game long. But when it comes down to a shootout, a goalkeeper has to step up and make those saves, and Gomez has been that guy for Georgetown. Leikvang steps up, and that's just an easy save, almost right down the middle. Easy save for Gomez. Georgetown moves on.
How about this reaction? First ever NCAA College Cup Finals that they have gotten to, and they will play for the title on Sunday against the winner
of Indiana and Creighton. Thomas Gomez was huge against San Diego in the NCAA playoffs, and now they will play in the finals. Sasha Sarofsky and Maryland are out. They came into this one the heavy favorites. They battled back in this one, Taylor, in a game that we might have felt that Georgetown really controlled for most of the night.
Well, Georgetown did.
Found a way.
And Sarofsky said something at halftime to get his team back on track. They reacted extremely well in the second half to get that game to 4-4. Francois had an opportunity right before going into halftime, going into overtime. Wonderful opportunity, hit it over, but Georgetown came into this game with a game plan. They executed it very well.
So Monica Gonzalez with one of the stars of the game for Georgetown, Steve Newman.
Steve, take us into the huddle right before penalty kicks. What was being said?
Our coach just said all the hard work was done. We got through 110 minutes and just do what you know what you can do. Everyone put it in their spot. We had a penalty shootout earlier in the tournament, and we won that one too. And Gomez made a big save at the air at the end there, and we're just happy to get the win and move on to the championship. Unreal feeling.
What makes this Georgetown team so special?
I think it's our resiliency. I mean, we're up 4-2 and gave up two goals, but we still had the fight to come back and not lose it in overtime, and then get the win in PKs. And I think we've been a resilient bunch all year, and it's tough to beat us, man.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Hat trick for Steve Newman, also scored one of the penalties. Here's the brackets. Georgetown advancing 4-3 on penalty kicks. They will play the winner of Indiana and Creighton, which is coming up on ESPNU.
Good luck living up to that game.
Will be Sunday on ESPN. Final score here from Hoover. What was an amazing game. Georgetown 4, Maryland 4. They win it on penalties. A reminder, 7:30 Eastern, live here on ESPNU, semifinal number 2. Indiana will take on Creighton. 8-goal thriller here. Coming up next, SportsCenter U. For Taylor Twellman, Monica Gonzalez, I'm Glenn Davis. You just saw an 8-goal thriller here in Hoover. Georgetown, for the first time ever, will go to their first appearance in the College Cup Final after knocking off Maryland. We return with the semifinal, number 2, Indiana Creighton, in just a few minutes. Stay tuned on ESPNU.
This is SportsCenter U.
Welcome to SportsCenter U. Anish Shroff here with Tom Lugan.
What a beaut.
Georgetown snaps a 28-game losing streak against Maryland. The Hoyas move on to the College Cup Final Sunday at 2 Eastern against on ESPNU against the winner of Creighton and Indiana. That's the next game here on ESPNU.
You're just too excited, weren't you?
Getting ahead of ourselves. Creighton,
double
Indiana.
Double OT, some penalty kicks.
Coming up next here on the U, that's in about 45 minutes. We do have some news from the other kind of football, though.
Yeah, that's right.
Tennessee's long football search for a head coach is over. The Vols introducing Butch Jones as their new coach today. He spent the last 3 years at Cincinnati. Previous 3 years, he spent at Central Michigan. In his 6 years as a head coach, his teams have claimed 4 league titles. So you add Butch Jones to this list of new head coaches in college football vacancies filled. Gus Malzahn going back to Auburn. He was the OC for that 2010 championship team. The big surprise, Brett Bielema jumping from Wisconsin to Arkansas. Well, Tennessee, they went for Gruden, couldn't get him. Charlie Strong was in the mix, couldn't get him. They get Butch Jones. What did you make of the hire?
I like the hire. Butch Jones has won everywhere he has been. Going back to Central Michigan, taking over for Brian Kelly, and then taking over for Brian Kelly again at Cincinnati. Don't worry about the big name. I know that's what you wanted, Tennessee Vol fans. Worry about the right coach. If you stay in the SEC, I also like the hire at Auburn. I think it was the right fit at the right time. And amongst the fan base, it's the only assistant. And I know he was a head coach last year at Arkansas State, went 9-3, won the Sun Belt Conference. earning another bowl bid. But when it comes to guys that were available, this is probably the only coach that was going to satisfy the masses, because the one thing Gus Malzahn brings to this job is an identity of who you are on offense. I think that's the biggest thing they lost a year ago with last year's staff. And so now it will be interesting to see how Gus Malzahn puts together his new staff. I know Ellis Johnson coming on the defensive side of the football, but I like the fit there on the Plains as well.
Ellis Johnson, another guy fired after just one season at Southern Miss. And, of course, the other big change, Brett Bielema going from Wisconsin to Arkansas. The College Football Awards last night, notable winners, no surprise there. Marquise Lee of USC wins the Biletnikoff. That goes to the best wide receiver. Jonathan Banks of Mississippi State wins the Jim Thorpe Award. Doak Walker goes to the best running back. Monte Ball of Wisconsin really came on strong. The Davey O'Brien Award goes to the nation's best quarterback.
Stunner.
Johnny Manziel. Is this a harbinger of things to come? Yeah.
Could be.
And then the Maxwell Award, which is kind of like the Heisman, but it's not called the Heisman. That went to Manti Te'o, which makes you think.
Finalists for the annual Heisman Trophy.
If a guy like Manti Te'o is not going to win the Heisman, they should just make it an offensive
award. I think Johnny Manziel is going to win the Heisman. Johnny Manziel played out of his mind.
Colin Klein should take home the trophy.
He should take it home.
So surreal.
If the Heisman comes along the way, I'll be happy.
I learned that or have recognized me.
Category in the same sentence as a Heisman Trophy. It's a dream come true.
We are down to three Heisman Trophy finalists. Colin Klein, the second Heisman finalist from Kansas State. Back in 1998, Michael Bishop was runner-up to Ricky Williams. Johnny Manziel trying to become the first freshman ever to win the award. Johnny Football would join John David Crow as the only other Texas A&M player to win the Heisman. And Notre Dame's Manti Te'o trying to become the first strictly defensive player to win the Heisman. Charles Woodson of Michigan won in 97. He was primarily a defensive player, but did play offense as well. So two-thirds of the field, we could be looking at history with Manziel, the freshman, Manti Te'o, the defensive player. All three of the Heisman Trophy finalists stopped by the DirecTV mobile studio earlier today.
It'd be a dream come true for me to be able to be the first freshman to win the honor and to bring a Heisman Trophy back to Texas A&M. Just the pride that it would bring to not only my family, but everybody at Aggieland and everybody involved with the Texas A&M program. It'd mean the world.
It'd mean a lot, and not only for myself, but as a representative of my school and, you know, my defense. And, you know, I wouldn't be here without my defense, you know, starting off with my D-line and with my corners and my safeties and, you know, my other linebackers that play with me. You know, I'm one piece to that puzzle. And, you know, for me to represent them in this capacity is what, you know, I'm really excited about. The Heisman goes to the best player in college football, and it has, you know, for the past couple of years. And, you know, it will go to the best, you know, player this year. So whoever wins it deserves it. And, you know, I'm just glad to be here and with Johnny and with Colin. And, you know, we're going to enjoy our experience here in New York.
Manziel and Te'o are looked at as the front runner. Mm-hmm. Klein, the dark horse, if you believe, you know, the early polls and the straw polls that certain publications have taken. It looks like it's going to come down to Manziel and Te'o. Let's start with Manziel's Heisman case. The freshman factor, how much do you think voters end up holding that against him?
I think that that's going to be a factor with an older generation of voters, more traditionalists that feel like, oh, you know, he's got three more years to do it. Although that didn't affect Tim Tebow, who won it as a sophomore. You know, I think a lot of it depends on what your criteria is for the Heisman Trophy. And in my criteria, Johnny Manziel wins hands down because he's had fantastic moments against great opponents when it's been nationally televised. I think Colin Klein, in my opinion, is an awful lot like Eric Crouch was, where you sit there and you say, wow, I'm really impressed with the body of work, but there's really nothing flashy. On the other hand, if you look at the team and you say, if you took him off the team, would they suffer the most out of the three candidates? And then Manti Te'o defensively, as great a player as he is, maybe there's an argument that maybe he's not even the best defensive player in college football, let alone the most outstanding player. I think that's up for debate, but I know this. He's tied for the most takeaways of any player in college football takeaway single-handedly on his own, I think that speaks volumes.
If it comes down to Manziel and Tao, it almost feels the argument is the best player in college football against the best player on what is the number one team. You want to say the best team, you can say the best team in college football. You know, in the past, sometimes that has been, that's gotten more weight, that latter half. Voters have said, hey, you're the best player on the best team. You don't have to be the best player in college football to win the award.
Happened with Gino Toretta in Miami. He might not have been the best player on his own team. So, just goes to show.
Well, we play a little Heismanology now with Joe Tessitore and Kirk Herbstreit.
Holiday weekend in New York, Heisman weekend in a place famous for its statues, but we're going to focus in on the one that weighs 25 pounds of bronze and is only 13 and a half inches tall. Joe Tessitore and Kirk Herbstreit with you here at the Best Buy Theater. And Herbie, I'm going to let you play with the toy this year.
I'm in.
You get to join me at the Heisman touchscreen here as we focus in on our three finalists. A lot of talk about Johnny Manziel and what he did statistically this year, but I felt a lot of times when you watch Manziel, you could go through Heisman history and pick out some guys that he just reminds you of, just the style of play, right?
Well, 1984, Doug Flutie. I mean, when I watched him in the first game this year against Florida, and he did about, he was 10 yards across the line of scrimmage, and he did a pump fake, you know, 10 yards across, and yet the defender fell for it. And he just did some things, almost like a no-look pass, that reminded me of some of the things we used to see from Doug Flutie, just that ability to improvise, the ability to be creative, and at the same time, when he needed to, stay within the confines of the offense. I think it's remarkable to consider that a freshman could understand it's a very slippery slope between being crazy out there and at the same time understanding what you need to do to make your offense and your offensive coordinator effective.
Yeah, Flutie-esque at times.
Yeah.
And, you know, the other thing, history could be made if it's Manziel with a freshman, but history could also be made with Manti Te'o, a purely defensive player. That has never happened. Woodson obviously played special teams back in 97.
The big thing he has going for him is Notre Dame made a run. They're 12-0. They're in the national championship. I felt really all along his candidacy had everything to do with not just the year he was having, but the year that Notre Dame enjoyed. And the fact that they got to the national championship, the fact that he continued to come up with big play after big play, I think gives him legitimacy as far as being in New York. And I really think if you followed Notre Dame this year, you really understand that they're 12-0, but it's not just about they have the best players. It's the chemistry. It's the intangibles, that aspect of the game, which to me starts with him. He's kind of the pulse of that football team, and that's why he's here.
At 1980, Herbie, is the last time we had a guy who exclusively played defense come close to winning Heisman. How good was
Pretty,
Hugh Green?
Pretty dynamic.
How good was
Maybe
Hugh
best
Green?
Ever.
And Tao's right there this year.
Yeah.
He could pull it off. Let's get back to our finalists and focus in on Colin Klein. Now, here's a guy. You can apply stats, but much like what you described with Manti Te'o, those leadership qualities and being a guy who just leads his team to success.
Last year, he was my favorite player in college football a year ago. And you watch what he did again this year. Now he had a big bullseye on his chest, and he still was able to go out and put up big numbers for his team. That slow, deliberate, the option play that took a lot of time. He showed a lot of patience. It's amazing when you talk to defensive coordinators, guys are saying, hey, we know what's coming, and we still can't stop it. He was also, as you said, he did some things that you just can't necessarily look at and appreciate unless you were in that locker room and really understanding what he provided, not just for the offense, but for the defense and everybody in that Kansas State community.
We're used to having a packed front row, Herbie.
I know.
We can get some extra seats here now. We only got three with us this year.
I love it.
Much anticipated. The Heisman Trophy presentation. Who will it be? You can find out Saturday at 8 on ESPN, the Heisman Trophy presentation presented by Nissan.
As Joe Tess just told us, 8 p.m. Eastern, Nissan presents the Heisman Trophy. You can watch it all unfold on ESPN, also on the Watch ESPN app.
You know Bo from those old commercials. You know him as the guy who ran up a wall to make a catch, the guy who was a video game legend, and the man whose career was cut too short too early. Saturday night, ESPN continues its 30 for 30 series with You Don't Know Bo. It's an examination of the truths and myths that defined one of the great sporting icons of our time. Here's an excerpt of what you'll see tomorrow night.
The day Bear Bryant called my house, it was like God calling. And the neighbors wanted to come up. Bear Bryant called you on that phone right there. Yep, called me on that phone. So people would, literally neighbors would come over and look at the phone. And then he said, I'm gonna send one of my coaches up to visit you, sit down and talk to him. Wow. It was during baseball season. I walk in the front door. There was a white man sitting at the table with my mother having coffee. He said, Bo, I know that you don't want to leave the state.
Oh my gosh. Let's talk about your movie, Christmas Day.
I'm so excited about this
parental movie. Parental Guidance. It's you and Bette Midler.
You work with a giant like that. It was the greatest. We had the greatest time. Marissa Tomei.
Oh, I love
these
her.
These three
too.
Great kids. We play grandparents coming to babysit for our kids while Marissa tries to go away.
And
she's
adorable. Kind of based on a true story. You had to
Yeah, with
babysit.
Me and my grandkids, yeah.
Yeah, it's unbelievably funny. And,
it's a good movie.
It's a good movie, yeah. I do love it. It's, we have a clip of this.
I play a minor league baseball announcer who's a little old school, and the town loves him, and this is after the last game of the season, which he thinks has been great, and this is what he finds out.
Billy Crystal, Parental Guidance.
Well, as the great Yogi Berra once said, it ain't over till it's over. Well, this Fresno Grizzly season is over. I'm Artie Decker, the voice of the Fresno Grizzlies. Good night, everybody. Thanks for listening, and lights out, Alice. I love this job. I'm fired?
I'm sorry, Artie. I'm changing everything. New logos, new uniforms, new music. We need someone who's wired in.
To what?
Facebook. How many friends do you have?
I don't have any friends.
Have you made any posts?
No.
What was your last update?
My what?
Have you poked anybody?
I haven't poked anybody.
Has anybody poked you?
No.
The thing is, Artie, even if you were connected, I don't know that I'd want to be poked by you. How many apps do you have?
I don't have any apps.
You don't have any apps?
No.
Everyone has apps.
I don't have an app.
Hashtag.
Huh?
When was the last time you hashtagged?
Are you out of your mind? What the heck are you talking about?
We need announcers to tweet.
I'll tweet. I'll make whatever noise you want.
Sorry, Artie. My mind's made up.
That's what I'm talking about right there. Don't make any noise you want. Parental Guidance in theaters, Christmas Day. The great Billy Crystal, everybody.
Thank you so much.
Come back whenever. Tyson Chandler joins us next Thursday in the Bud Light Platinum.
Give the gift of Gautier with this distinctive Lamal holiday gift set. Available at Macy's, your fragrance destination.
They erased his memory.
Your mind was implanted with a life you think you've lived.
They changed his identity.
Why are you trying to kill me?
You haven't even begun to see me trying to kill you.
I want him alive. Total Recall. Now on Blu-ray and DVD.
Go Olive Garden's 2 for $25 Italian dinner. All the salad and breadsticks you want. Choose a shareable appetizer. Then two delicious entrees like smoked mozzarella chicken. Three courses, two people. Just $25. Go Olive Garden.
Gift.
I left it upstairs.
Viagra?
That was idiotic. You have to understand that.
The sort of sequel to Knocked Up is honest and hilarious.
Sometimes I think you want to kill me.
I do want to kill you.
How would you do it?
Poison your cupcakes. I would enjoy our last few months together, but while killing you.
Tomorrow comes the must-see Christmas comedy that's laugh-out-loud funny.
Let's just get happy.
I think we need to turn the gas down.
Turn it up.
This is 40, rated R, in theaters tomorrow.
Research suggests cell health plays a key role throughout our lives. One A Day Men's 50 Plus is a complete multivitamin designed for men's health concerns as we age. It has 7 antioxidants to support cell health. One A Day Men's 50 Plus.
Typical family living in a typical neighborhood.
If this girl were the last piece of pizza on earth,
I would lick her.
Just ask her out.
The perfect daughter.
You remember that time we played one-on-one, didn't have a goalie, and we bowled a strike?
Wait, are you pregnant?
Seriously, that made sense to you?
And a dad with the launch codes to nuclear weapons.
One disrespectful word to my daughter, I will find you. I have robots that roam the skies.
1600 Penn. New episode premiere Thursday, January 10th after The Office here on NBC.
It's the Lazy Boy holiday sale. Get two great chairs for one low price. It's your choice. Match them up or mix it up. Like a pair of recliners from only $5.99 plus special financing. Lazy Boy Furniture Galleries. Live life comfortably.
New Balance invites you to both of our stores in Albuquerque with the latest New Balance shoes, apparel, and more. And as always, we actually measure your feet. With women's size 5 through men's 16 and widths from AA through 6E. New Balance Albuquerque. Shoes and apparel that fit just right. Shoes that fit better, feel better, and perform better, no matter what size feet you've got. On Juan Thibault, north of Constitution, and next to Best Buy in Cottonwood Corners.
I remember the moment.
I'll never forget that moment.
That changed my life.
At that moment, it hit me. This is why I joined the Guard. We're soldiers, always ready to protect our country. But we've also got communities. Family, friends, neighbors who count on us. I couldn't believe it. I just saved a life. Somebody from my hometown.
See what it means to be a citizen soldier at NationalGuard.com.
It's the Lazy Boy holiday sale. Get two great chairs for one low price. It's your choice. Match them up or mix it up. Like a pair of recliners from only $5.99 plus special financing. Lazy Boy Furniture Galleries. Live life comfortably.
KOB.com, New Mexico's most popular local news website.
Gold medalist, NBA champion, and the 2012 NBA Defensive Player of the Year. Please welcome the starting center for the New York Knicks, Tyson Chandler. You look great, my friend. Nice to see you.
Thank you.
Can you just tell everyone, I just want to tell everyone, last night you dunked. You yes. dunked really hard dunk. Like it was almost too hard for the human league. They should have fined you. It was that how hard of it. It was a beautiful dunk. And at the end of it, you pounded your chest and you told me backstage you find someone in the crowd and you just make eye contact with somebody.
Yes, some complete stranger. I never know who it is. It's probably an awkward moment for both of us, but
why do you do that though? Why?
I don't know. I don't know who I am when I'm on the basketball court. That's a totally different person.